Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Berks Perspectives. It's the sun is shining. It's not raining for a change. No snow to speak of yet, so we're off and running here. And I hope everyone is doing well. Our panel is fully loaded today. We have with us Tom Gallagher.
Who, by the way, is not loaded, actually. Just I might look that way, but
and he's also coming from an undisclosed location. He won't tell us where the hell he is. But and we have John Forrester with us.
Hello, and I'm Ben Canors.
Yes, we figured as much. And Ruth Martelli.
Hi, how are you?
Excellent.
Good, I hope.
Good to see you. And Martha Richardson.
Hi, everybody. Good to see everybody.
And the irrepressible Fred Opalinski.
From the city of Reading. Good to see you all.
There he is. So thanks. It's a great day to get started. So I thought we might start with some more locally oriented stuff before we dive into the deep end of the pool and the other stuff. We have spoken occasionally, quite a number of times actually, about childhood mortality and mothers that have problems with childbirth and so on. And I caught a glimpse on the Hub, the BCTV website thing, about an upcoming program that was going to be sponsored by the League of Women Voters and included Senator Judy Schwank and some other local folks that were talking about this very subject. And I have not, I'm sorry to admit, have had a chance to look at it. But I alerted Martha to it, who has been very engaged in this issue, and I was hoping that she could give us some idea what was happening. And again, I like the idea that it was a local program as opposed to some national statistic. So Martha, what did you learn?
Well, I wasn't able to watch the program last night, but I did catch a program that the League of Women Voters had on BCTV on the 15th of December. Also talking about maternal mortality, and it was a very interesting show, and I suspect that last night may have been an update. Judy Schwank was on the panel, and Dr. Chelsea Marks, who was from the Berks Community Health Center, and Dr. Mark Woodland from Howard Tower Health, I believe. He's the head of the OBGYN program there, and also an instructor at the Temple Medical School. It was a very interesting discussion. They started talking about, the panelist from League of Women Voters was Judith Cranes, and she started out by talking about the fact that in the European Union, there are 100,000 births, 5 mothers in 100,000 that die. In the United States, it's 28 out of 100,000. But of Black mothers, Black and brown mothers in the United States, it's 55 out of 100,000. Going on to some positive things, in 2018, Pennsylvania established a federally funded mortality review committee. I believe Judy Schwank is on it. And they started publishing and tried to start getting data on maternal mortality, which, by the way, includes not just death of the mother prior to or during delivery, but anywhere up to months and months after delivery, from all sorts of reasons, some because of care isn't given, some because of psychiatric problems. What they found was they had a hard time getting information. And in the meantime, very recently, Judy Schwenk has proposed and had a bill passed, Act 5, in 2023, which focuses on maternal mortality in Pennsylvania. And it is also working on deaths after postpartum deaths. As I said, the highest rate is among Blacks and immigrants. And the sad part is that in many parts of the state, there are what they call healthcare deserts. And one of those, for instance, is in Kane, Pennsylvania. Judy mentioned that they had visited Kane, Pennsylvania, where there is absolutely no local help for, no OBGYN help. And in that case, many pregnant women go to New York for help. She said the plus side of this is that, at least in Pennsylvania, those healthcare deserts are within maybe 45 or 50 miles, whereas in other parts of the country, they may be more than a day's drive. The community health, Berks County Community Health Center, deals primarily, but not only, with Medicaid patients, but also with any patients, whether they have insurance or no insurance at all. They provide all services right there, which is one of the problems that cause infant or that cause mothers to die during or before or after childbirth, because they have to travel from one place to another to get assistance for themselves and their children, and they don't have schedules that allow them to do that. Let's see, in Pennsylvania, Governor Shapiro put $2.3 million into this current proposed budget for maternal health. And so he is very much a proponent for trying to get these things done. The Community Health Center, Berks County Community Health Center, is really doing an excellent job. They dovetail with Tower Health. All kinds of treatment and help is available in Berks County for pre-delivery and after delivery, except apparently fetal surgery. And we send those cases out of Berks County to another facility. It's just a very interesting discussion. They said one of the reasons that there are problems with gaining information is that it's kept in so many different ways. And one of the reasons that there are these deserts of no OBGYN care is that unless a facility has at least 500 deliveries a year, they can't make any money. It is one of the most risky services and one of the most expensive services that a healthcare facility can provide. And for that reason, they really have just not been able to be financed in certain areas of the state as well as in the country. Let's see, what else can I tell you? The other problem that was cited by Dr. Woodland is that unfortunately, there is a lack of non-white people going into OBGYN. They're not sure why. They're trying to change that, but that's one of the problems. They admitted racism is alive and well. Many Black pregnant women do not want to go to the hospital because the staff doesn't listen to them, doesn't seem to understand their problems. And I think the good part is that we admit that that's a problem and has to be dealt with. And I have read that before, that many, many Black and brown women say they go to the hospital, they try to talk to the doctors about the problems they're having or to the OBGYN staff, and they just don't pay any attention to them. They just go through their normal routines, and even if they are not normal pregnancies. Berks County has a lower maternal mortality rate than many of our neighboring counties or many other counties in Pennsylvania. It's a problem. I believe they decided that in 2020, there were 4,362 deaths, births in Pennsylvania. In Berks County, 86% of those were actually treated appropriately, but we still have a low birth rate is a major problem, again, because many mothers don't have the transportation or the schedules to go from one place to another for help. And that's where the community health center is really doing a great job, because they bring everyone to the health center. When a pregnant woman goes there or mother goes there, she can get all the help she needs, including any WIC support that she can get from the state. It's a problem, and it's one that I was glad to hear them admit the fact that racism plays a part in it. It's there. We can't turn our back to it. And I think Judy Schwenk is just a treasure, because this is one of her focuses. Women's health has been a focus of hers forever. And the fact that she is proposing bills and getting them passed to make things better is just huge. I don't know if you have any questions.
Ruth, you have shared Martha's passion in this subject. What's your take?
Community Health Center is in my old neighborhood, pretty much adjacent to the Albright campus. And there is a center, a WIC center, where women can take their kids and sign up for WIC. When the pandemic was in its heyday and we were getting shots, those were given to the entire community, no matter who you were or where you lived, at the community center, which I thought was a great idea, because it brought all kinds of people together under one roof. I've read exactly what Martha has, that there just seems to be a barrier when Black and brown women try to talk to people who aren't of their color. They are disrespected to some extent, and certainly not listened to in the way that a doctor may listen to his other patients.
There's some other problems here that haven't been addressed. One is the politics of the American Medical Association, which has really cracked, discouraged midwifery. Women, you know, pregnancy wasn't treated as a disease until the early part of the 20th century, and mostly because of the AMA. It was births were done in the home, not in a hospital. It's pregnancy is not a disease. The other part of it is our litigious society. This goes back to when I was a reporter many years ago. Obstetricians, you know, you talk about OBGYN. There are a lot of doctors just practicing gynecology and not of the obstetrics part of it, because of our litigious society. If a child is born with a problem, the first call that's made is to a lawyer who will sue. There, because of that, liability insurance, medical liability insurance, went up for obstetricians, and many obstetrics practices closed down because they just didn't want to pay the high insurance rates. I think for obstetrics, the insurance is almost as high as a general surgeon, if not higher, because of the courts. And juries tend to be very generous with a plaintiff who is suing on behalf of a mother who's a couple who's lost a child. You know, it's a tragedy. Yes, is it always the doctor? I don't know.
It seems extraordinary to me, though, that a childbirth in a hospital setting would be more dangerous than doing it at home. I mean, where you don't have so many of the things available to doctors in a hospital. I mean, that's astonishing.
And I can tell you this from personal experience, having had a child in Italy when I didn't speak English, I didn't speak Italian, and there was no one who spoke English. And I was delivered by a midwife. I can't speak highly enough for midwives. I think John is right. We are paying more attention to midwives and to doulas, and I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that correctly. Ruth, you would know. But the telehealth in Reading Hospital has established a birthing center, and I believe that's over in Shillington, where they've focused completely on birth. But again, if you have women who don't speak the language, or if you have women that the OBGYN staff has decided are too ignorant to really know what's going on because of the way they sound or the way they look or the way they dress, and believe me, that happens, the care isn't there. It's just not there. And it's a very, very dangerous time for many women to go into a hospital. And it's why many women choose to have home births if they can find a midwife.
And Fred O, as a retired member of the clergy, do the churches participate in sponsoring midwives or any role at all in that?
I'm not aware of that in particular. A lot of congregations have parish nurses which work with health care in general in the congregation. I don't know of anybody who might be doing midwifery. Seventh-day Adventists, I suspect, would be big on this because they are very much interested in health care and health in general. But I don't know of anything specifically. I did see in, I think it was today's paper, that the Jewish Federation Foundation has awarded, I think, a $200,000 grant to Harvest. What's the Berks Food Bank?
Healthy Harvest.
Healthy Harvest. Yeah, to Healthy Harvest, specifically for mothers and children's health and well-being. I mean, I think it's related to this issue in particular. I mean, I don't know, when the statistics are so fuzzy, I don't know how much of this might be related to nutritional needs, but that grant ought to go, I think, a long way in Berks County to help that specific part of the population.
Well, in some cases, it's... pregnant women are often prescribed prenatal vitamins. So if you don't have a doctor that you're seeing, then that's something that you wouldn't have access to. I just looked it up, Martha, and it's pronounced doula.
Okay, doula.
My niece is a midwife in England, and they are, she's had intensive instruction, and she's well respected. She shared with us a letter that she got from a couple whose child she delivered, and it's different than being in a kind of aesthetic or in a hospital setting. But obviously it's personal choice. We aren't ill when we're pregnant. We could become ill because of appropriate care. But it's not an illness, it's not a disease, it is a natural occurring phenomenon. The other thing that's happening though too, Martha, I fear, is that because of the really tenuous legality of abortion, a lot of OBGYNs are avoiding the field as well. Because first they're supposed to do no harm. How's that possible? When you are in the dark when it comes to treatment of women who are in some peril because of their pregnancy.
The other thing that's making it more dangerous and pregnancy, I know women, you know, had their babies out in the fields and then went out and picked rice afterwards. That's easy to say if you're not a woman. It's not a picnic by any means. And you know, it's a joyful, wonderful time if you're healthy. And if you have regular regular obstetric care prior to the birth and a doctor picks up that you have health problems, they'll be treated. But many of these women, especially because today, older women, pregnancy, the average age of the pregnant woman is older than it was. And with older women come more problems with blood pressure and all sorts of other situations that a younger woman may not have had. We're, again, not prepared to deal with these, especially if it's with a black or brown woman who is afraid to tell the doctor that this may be wrong, or she may not take her seriously. And let me not just say that these are not male, these are not all male gynecologists that were, or OBGYNs that we're talking about. There are some women as well.
Tom, Martha cited a statistic that indicated that the childbirth mortality rate was far lower in Europe. Given the enormous amount of immigration there's occurred in many European countries, you know, what do you hear over there?
Well, what I wanted to say, and I can kind of get onto that, is that what we're talking about is a problem that is developing. It's getting worse. We're looking at maternal mortality rates that have tripled in almost 20 years. And I'm not so sure that the things that we have been putting our fingers on weren't existent in the year 2000. So I think the aging thing of mothers is probably one of those factors that has contributed to it. Deserts of care that are out there, I think that's part of it. But I think in talking to, because we've talked about this before, so I've talked to people I know who are in the field, a lot of them would put the finger on the health of the patient, the health of the mother. We're looking at a much more unhealthy group of mothers. Obesity would be one of the most commonly cited elements in there. And obesity has the highest correlation with maternal mortality, along with a lot of other complications, along with pregnancy, blood pressure, et cetera.
Interestingly enough, the doctor from Tower Health did say that they had no COVID-related maternal deaths at the Reading Hospital, which is a pretty amazing thing, because they said actually the number of maternal deaths went down during COVID, and they were very happy to say that they had had none. I read a thing this morning, I guess, about the babies being born and die, and the mothers who are pregnant and dying in Gaza. And you know, again, we just can't say we're pro-life when we're really not.
Well, she brought up the Gaza and all that. The U.S. statistics, as they are right now, actually, and this is prior to the Israeli-Gaza fighting that's going on now, we're comparable to the West Bank and to Gaza. Our maternal mortality rates are comparable to theirs.
Yes.
So I caution people about thinking that it's necessarily a money issue, because those are not areas that invest heavily in healthcare. A quality can be done without more money being put into it. And I think that there's certainly some things that need to be addressed in there.
Yeah, and factor in pregnancy is nutrition, and you talk about people of color having higher incidence of death rates. They are also located in areas where there's food deserts. They don't have access to fresh fruits and vegetables and lean meats and things. So they feast on McDonald's and fries and junk food. And that's why you have obesity in the inner cities a problem, and I'm sure this follows the nutritional trail.
When I was looking for a gynecologist, I found one in Reading, an OBGYN. And at that point, my son was born in 1980. I was an older mother, but nobody ever talked to me about testing, genetic testing to make sure that he would be okay. They did, however, when I was carrying my daughter at 38, when I was 38, not her. But how many doctors are in Philadelphia, Center City, Reading anymore?
Right.
Not many. Mm-hmm. Doctors and lawyers are among the first people who left town, really. And many practices are
hospitals.
Now in the suburbs.
There are no hospitals in Reading anymore.
Well, there is, but it's...
In the city.
It is in the city. St. Joe's still operates.
In the old Community General Hospital?
You bet. I have for years had my mammograms done there. Yeah, there's a mental ward. Some people with mental illness can get treatment there. It still functions, not at the level it did before.
It's a satellite clinic, though. It's mm-hmm. I mean, St. Joe's is Alburn Township now.
I would bet that many. Many people in the inner city don't have a history of a relationship with a doctor that lots of us take for granted.
Yeah, and I can recall, as a matter of fact, I lived in the neighborhood for a while around St. Joe's Hospital on North 11th Street, the first and second blocks were chock-a-block with doctor's offices. They were surrounded by doctor's offices and specialists, too. But they're gone.
Betcha.
Well, this has been a very interesting conversation, and I hope our audience would agree with us in that. It is a subject that we have visited before, and I'm absolutely certain we will again. It's something that really needs to be talked about. And maybe next time we could start to talk a bit more about solutions, all right, we recognize the issue or the problem, but now what the dickens are we going to do about it? And I'd like to kind of go in that direction next time. But there's also some other stuff that we ought to talk about here in our limited time. And keeping on the local front, Reading's got a new police chief. There continues to be issues with crime in the city and so on, and the police department could stand to have a few more people added to it, but now a new chief. What I wanted to ask the panel about is this gentleman has come from Tampa, Florida. I have gone through promoting some officers to higher positions, including chief, in our borough department, and I have always been a strong believer in promoting from within as opposed to going outside. But this gentleman, who I hope will do a fantastic job, has come, as I said, from Florida. So panel, what's your take on all this?
Well, I've gone through several police chiefs in Reading, okay, from Charlie Wade back in the Kibaki administration, to Bernie Dubinsky, who was the chief forever. And the tenure of chiefs kept getting shorter and shorter. And mostly they, like you said, they promoted from within, which was good. The chief had a better perspective on the community, I think, than when they started bringing in chiefs from the outside. I believe Chief Heim was the first one they brought in. It's very important that the police department has a relationship with the city. And has an understanding of the citizens and the different neighborhoods and the different problems there. and the people who live there. You can't just bring in somebody with a 4-year degree in law enforcement and a little experience and let him or her expect them to know the city and to know the area, the borough or the city or the township too. I mean, it's across the board.
But remember the last time we got together, we talked about the number of Hispanics who were holding positions in government on city council and in the mayor's office. I didn't read that report, so I don't know whether this gentleman is Latino or not, but yes, it yes. could in yes. fact be that he will bring some sort of expertise to the community that has now become a majority community. I don't know why we would be surprised.
John, I think your point is a very good one. When you bring someone in to head a group that deals primarily with the public, and my experience has been with school superintendents, when you bring a superintendent, just like a chief police, a police chief from another area, comes in with all kinds of ideas, what they really need to do is study the community and really know what's going on now, what's worked, what's not worked. And I know from experience, sometimes you bring in a superintendent who decides that everything she's seen is wrong and she's going to completely redo everything without any idea of the background of the district and what's going on, what the people need, what the teachers need, and so forth. I'm sure the same thing can happen with a police chief coming in with all kinds of grand ideas that, you know, in Tampa we did this, in Tampa we did that. This is Reading, and it has its own set of ideas. And I certainly hope that he takes some time to really look at what's going on and what has worked and what has worked well. And there have been some things that have really worked well in Reading, rather than this, you know, a new broom sweeps clean. Well, yeah, but the new broom very often sweeps out some really good stuff that really should be kept.
Yeah, and police departments are internally very political too.
Hey.
And it's been my experience that you can't just plug in a name and expect the rank and file to stand at attention and salute. They have to earn the respect of the rank and file mm-hmm. uniform.
Has this man taken office yet?
I think so. Yes. Just like now. I mean, very, very recent. Now, Fred Opalinski, as a city resident, do you have any particular thoughts on this?
I agree with what Ruth and John said in terms of promoting from within somebody that already knows the system and knows the personnel and the problems and all the rest. However, I was impressed by what was printed about this man's experience and philosophy. And one of the things that rang good for me was his desire to treat everybody with respect and to have his officers doing that as well. To be, you know, I mean, he seemed to be a champion of human rights in that regard. He didn't mention the problems of police brutality, but you know, I got the idea that he wanted his force to be dealing with people in a respectful way. Well, we'll see what happens. Tampa, Florida, and Reading, Pennsylvania are, I'm sure, very, very different communities. And I wish him the best. It's a very important role in the community, that's for sure.
Any thoughts, Tom, before we move on?
Nope, and you got me at a quiet moment here locally, so I'll just be brief and say no, I don't really have anything to add.
Tom seems to be situated in a dog kennel today. You notice the noise in the background. Another local thing that public's been engaged with is that we've had a lot of construction of huge warehouses. Now, a lot of that has to do with our physical location geographically here being so close to a lot of other markets and so on. But some of the facilities are to serve the local community. Like Amazon has a facility, a large facility here, and that's just to deliver stuff to our respective doorsteps. But the public sometimes gets excited about having one built near where they live. There was one down on Route 10 near Flying Hills that received a good bit of pushback and has been stalled. There's been a lot of news about one up in Maxitawny, or is it Maiden Creek, but up Route 222. is a large field right along Route 222, which for a long time, in my experience, had a sign on it saying there was a big shopping center coming, but it never happened. But now the proposal was for a warehouse, and there's been strong pushback against it, and now that developer has actually, just in the last day or so, withdrawn their plan and came back with a revised plan, which hasn't been vetted yet, but I'm sure the issues are going to remain pretty much the same. There's another one that's been in the news for the site of the old Kutztown Airport, right? As you enter Kutztown, immediately adjacent to the university, was an airfield, and there was a proposal for one there, and that's been fought by the local residents. So, panel, you're the deep thinkers here. What's your perspective on these things?
I wouldn't get too excited about warehouses. I just read an article a couple minutes ago about the Amazon warehouses laying off 300 contract workers. It's a cyclical. Is it wholesale or retail? I'm not sure. I guess that's this distance retail business is cyclical and seasonal, and I don't think that it's going to. I'd hate to see these warehouses that were built throwing up all over the place. Pardon the term, turn into what our malls, retail malls, are doing. I mean, we have the Fairgrounds Mall, which is defunct. We have the Berkshire Mall, which is problematic. And these are short in the terms of the long-term community. These are short-lived institutions, and I'd like to see something more substantial, like affordable housing, be put up in these areas.
A lot of those layoffs, John, I think have to do with the kind of downsizing after the pandemic, that while we were all stuck at home, everybody was ordering everything online. I mean, I have a son who I kiddingly say would order a ham sandwich on from Amazon. It's just everything. The Amazon truck is parked in our driveway, it seems, every day. So a lot of that layoff had to do with the pandemic's over and they don't need as many people in that regard. But you're right, there are ups and downs. You get to the holiday season and so on, and it's obviously busier than it is other times. Tom, you got something to add there?
Well, one of the other things we're going to see in warehousing is automation. So there's going to be a lot fewer people involved in it. It's going to increase some efficiency. The more of the automation and logistics tech work is going to be done with that. So I think we're going to actually see them getting more out of less space in the future. We just have to remember that this stuff is really pretty much all demand driven. And as much as we might like to see demand for other things, higher wage employment or housing, the builders are out there, they're really looking to make money. So they'll build on land with what that use is going to do is going to work there. And I remember.
We've invaded breath.
I think
here,
I may have told this story before. This is Altman, and it was up in the Scranton-Wilkes-Barre area, and we're looking at, sorry. What was that?
We have Tom freezing up a bit here, so. Well, hold that thought, Tom. I think a lot of good points were made here. As we kind of start thinking about some of the other issues facing us, we have talked long about the voting process. We're coming up on what's going to be a very hard-fought campaign. Berks County has now added a third drop box. You know, there's been conversations about security with drop boxes and where should they be, and the fact that there's a sheriff's deputy standing next to it for security is intimidating to some or whatever. But now we have had, over the last several elections, a drop box at the County Services Center here in downtown Reading. We've had one out at the Ag Center in Burn Township near the prison. And now a third. The county has established what they refer to as their South Campus, which houses, for actually one thing, is that's where they store the voting machines when they're not in use, but a bunch of other county-related services in Moton. As you drive into Moton from Shillington, it would be in there on the right-hand side, and somewhere in that complex is going to be another drop box. I mean, I'm sure it'll be well-marked and so on. Is that enough? Having three now, is that going to be adequate, panel, or are we still up in the air about it? And it doesn't prevent people from doing the mail thing as well, I ought to add. So, anybody?
With the last election, I decided to go to the drop box. I have been using mail since COVID, and I thought, I'll just go down to the county services building. There was one sign from Washington Street saying voting drop box to turn in on the street, but then nothing else. And I went back and forth on that street a couple of times because the signage was terrible. Hmm. I didn't realize, and perhaps I should have, that I needed to go inside the county services building, which means that I needed to park the car somewhere, get out and walk it in. So not convenient. Mm-hmm. Not easy to find. I did finally get it figured out, but I'll not be back there again. It's going to be back to the U.S. Postal Service or going just to vote. I mean, it was more troublesome than if I had just gone to the polls and dropped it off. But that's
also, I think,
my downtown experience.
I see some political problems with this. I mean, how do you determine where they're located? Make sure that Democrats get elected, I can make sure that the drop boxes are put in largely blue portions of the county, and there are those, and or I could, you know, conversely do red portions of the county. I see it being a potential problem, and I'd rather just not have them at all.
Well, I couldn't agree more with that, but I think that the locations are largely because election services is a county function, and all three of these locations are county buildings of some sort where they can provide what they feel is the necessary security and so on. That, you know, you hear all the stories about people going to a drop box in other parts of the country with an armful of ballots and stuffing them in the box. And here you can't do that. So whatever. But I think that's the only reason they are where they are, John.
I'm aware of that. But as I say, there's the potential for some chicken.
Sure. All right, well, we'll see how it pans out. We've been talking about the need for more
than... Can I piggyback on that?
Oh, please do.
Can I piggyback on that quickly, Fred?
Yes, go ahead, Tom.
Okay, I just filled in my ballot request for voting from abroad, and it is getting easier and easier to do that. And there is one place, I know we don't have a foreign audience here, but votefromabroad.org has become a very simple one-stop place to be able to handle all of this stuff. So I will get my ballot by email. I will have to mail it in, but I will get it by email for both the primary and for the general election.
Cool. Well, keep us posted on how all that goes. Now, Tom's audio isn't so hot there as you heard. We don't know exactly where he is because he simply won't tell us, but I'm now beginning to suspect he's on the international on the International Space Station or something, the way that sound came in. Another local thing, we have talked at some length about the school funding issue in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania, per the Pennsylvania Constitution, is supposed to supply a whole lot more money than they have been doing for many, many years. That's the reason your property taxes have gone up so much. I mean, of your real estate tax, about 70% of it is school tax, about 20% to the county, and the other 10% your municipal tax. So the 70% or so share of the property tax is the only thing that the school districts can really do if they're not getting enough money from the state and they have certain mandates they must reach and so on and so forth. So the only option is increase the property tax. So there has also been a lot of argument about whether or not the funding formula that the state uses is fair. Do the poorer, if that's the right word, school districts receive a adequate share of the state money as opposed to wealthier areas. Now there has been some consternation in that it's still not resolved. I mean, it was kind of mandated to be resolved. The governor wanted to add some element of charter schools, and the teacher unions pushed back hard, so that stalled and held up the entire budget for a little bit. So it's still not resolved, and a bunch of money apparently, it might be what Fred was just going to say, was directed toward construction projects as opposed to education. So
yeah, $100 million, according to the article in the paper.
Ruth and Martha are our resident teachers. So what do you think?
Building projects are always required by every superintendent. I believe you have to have a new building named after you, or I just thought that was the rule.
That's a rather cynical view of things here, Martha.
I'm very cynical about a lot of things dealing with education. And one of them is the funding and the inequity in the funding that is going into schools. I don't know how we can solve it, but it's an ongoing and getting worse.
There's also, I think, a real crisis in support for public education. There's a whole legion of people who want my tax dollars to fund religious education, and I think that's wrong. It flies in the face, in my opinion, of the separation of church and state.
Absolutely.
And, you know, people who think that somehow, public education is ill-funded because I don't believe, fundamentally, people believe that every citizen should be educated.
Exactly.
And there are people who believe that there are some other people who should be treated like mushrooms, kept in the dark, and you know the rest of the story. If you have a highly educated, critically thinking population, a whole lot of stuff would not go by the wayside as it does now. But we don't educate kids in the way that they need to be educated, it seems to me. Nor do we highly anyway, go ahead, John, sorry.
Well, we have too many, one thing we have is too many school districts. We have too many.
Administrators.
We have too many beaks in the pot, too. And we have too many administrators too, because you have to keep promoting as people go through the steps in the salary steps and get more higher degrees and they end up as administrators. And I've seen the real top heavy school administrations. I don't know why we have 500 school districts in Pennsylvania when we have, 67 counties?
Yes.
We should have county-wide school districts, and thereby there'll be an economy of scale in there. The you won't have as many administrators. You won't have as much duplication, and you won't have as much waste. School choice, this thing with homeschooling and charter schools, yeah, it's all right, but it's depleting the quality of the public schools, system within the state, and people. It subverts the public school system.
Absolutely.
Martha?
I think the other thing I'd throw in with how the local school districts are structured as far as their size goes is that school district quality is a huge factor in people's deciding where to live. And what we do is we get a big socioeconomic segregation that occurs based on what school district you're in. And when they're very small, it makes it very easy to move to a nicer one for those people who can afford it. And I think land use and municipal governance is a huge part of the problem for why our schools are just so unequal.
Just for context, I will point out that John referenced that there's 500 school districts in the state. There are 18 in Berks County. So 18 right where in our backyards. Doesn't it seem that a large measure of the problem rests in the state legislature, where the contentiousness of, you know, Pennsylvania state legislature is hardly any different than the United States Congress, where it's about a 50-50 split and nobody agrees on anything and therefore nothing gets done.
It's almost as large.
Darn near, and almost as expensive.
Yeah.
Has it ever come before the state to consider countywide school districts?
There used to be countywide.
There was a county superintendent.
Oh, right.
System, and that was replaced by the intermediate units.
Yeah, actually, there used to be more school districts, and there was some sort of a mandate from the state kind of before my time to do mergers.
In the 60s, there were a lot of consolidations.
It might have been in the earlier 60s. You're right, Fred. Right. And it, Governor Mifflin's school district today was a result of combining the Moton and the Shillington schools. So there were a lot more than there are now, and there was that consolidation thing. And now some think it ought to happen again. But in the meantime, we have something like Antietam School District, which suffered terrible results of, and look how nice John turned out. He went there. They had that terrible flooding last summer, and kids are now scattered around as they try to figure out what to do with the building. But in the meantime, one of the things that they're looking at is potentially merging with somebody else, but nobody seems anxious to jump on that right now. So be an interesting story to see where it goes. Now, we are incredibly, to me at least, down to our last few minutes, and there are all kinds of stuff that I wanted to talk about. Panel, anything that's on your minds? I mean, we have the world at war and all the election stuff that we're going to have to talk about next time, I guess. Martha, you look like you have something.
Well, yeah, I'm concerned about our aid or lack thereof to Ukraine.
Mm-hmm. The issue
anybody
there,
else?
And obviously I am too. I was just going to say that it's probably a subject that maybe we wait for next week, and I wish there would be a resolution or some change in the news, but I don't think there will be. And I do hope that there will be better audio and video for me next week. So I just look to see where I will be, and I think it will be better. So,
well, the issue that Tom's referring to has a lot to do with the the contentiousness in Congress. We're looming another potential government shutdown, and one of the issues on the table is those in the Congress that want to combine aid to Ukraine and Israel and Taiwan, for that matter, to the southern border, of coming up with a solution there.
It's ridiculous.
Which has made it just incredibly complicated. Ruth?
I heard a commentator refer to a Putin wing in the Republican Party. Do you think that's accurate?
Personally, no, I don't. But
I don't think so either. What I do think that it is that they're operating on much of the same wavelength as far as their own personal political gain. And I think that's what we're seeing from a lot of those people who are being disruptors is that they really don't have proposals. They just really like being in a position of power.
I think Tom's correct on that. And I think Putin is just basically taking advantage of the situation. He's not in cahoots with them, I don't think. But we're down to a minute or two. I did want to say something. Now, you know how I've always enjoyed thinking about astronomy and things out there in the universe and all that stuff. I read an interesting story that a scientist came up with a theory that UFOs, because of the incredible distances from here to the next star, let alone one that's got any planets with any life on them, is so far away that this guy said it would, if there's somebody visiting us, it would have to be done with artificial intelligence, of being able not to put living beings of one sort or another. So as this guy's thinking that it's artificial intelligence as opposed to little green men. But that makes sense to me. The distances are so vast. When we look at those photographs from the new James Webb telescope that was put up 2 years ago, I guess, they're looking back. The light that's reaching us took billions of years to get here. I mean, so that distance is just astonishing.
Because of that, though, it makes me wonder why anybody would put that out as an effort, because radio transmission can't go any faster than the speed of light. Mm-hmm. And so it would take thousands or billions of years to get whatever information back to the folks who sent it. So it seems to me to be a pretty futile experiment unless they figured out some way to crack that. That law of physics, that as we see it anyway,
right. And somebody wormhole. Made. John,
wormhole. Yeah, could be. It's possible.
Yeah. Well, it makes for good movies and stuff like that. But I'm telling you, it's it just is a subject that fascinates me. So,
well, speaking of astronomy, though, I was sorry to see that attempted moonshot with the Pittsburgh lunar lander. Yeah. Is not gonna make it.
Well, that's part of the learning experience, and they'll get them next time. I'm very confident. You know, we've done incredible things, and more to come. So, panel, audience, I'm sorry, but it's time to say see you around. We're gonna have to be on our way, as Tom said.
It's next, a whole lot of stuff.
Next time, you know, we're gonna get to the other two-thirds of the list I put together. And talk about some of the world issues and the upcoming elections, which are, I mean, the Iowa caucuses are only like a week away. I mean, we're in it now. So,
hey, John, audience, if you could talk to the world and just tell them to hold up the news for a week so we can get caught up.
Yes, we'll just make everybody take time out or whatever. See you all next time. Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.